They decided to go with something designed in the old country in Britain. And that was the Franti Manchester Mark I, the first machine that I think was intended to be sold commercially. That was the machine I cut my teeth on. I see that you've reproduced here parts of the Creed teleprinter code. Stroke E add A colon S I U half D R J. Oh, it's all very familiar. These were the Creed teleprinter characters. And when you programmed this computer, you did it with these characters because there was no assembly language.
Yes. And there were five data channels on the tape, so there were not
that's right.
an enormous number of characters available.
Well, there were 32 characters available. The tape had five holes plus this thick small hole for the sprocket. The tape reader was a marvel. It was an electromechanical marvel. It had a magnetic clutch. Now, the clutch has two faces, one driven by a motor all the time, and the other one would drive the spindle for the tape reader. And they were both immersed in a cylinder filled with oil and ground up iron powder. And if there was no magnetic field, the driven disc would spin and it wouldn't have much effect on the other, which at its other end had a magnetic clutch to hold it still, you see. But when they wanted to move this spindle so that they could move the tape forward and its sprockets, they would unmagnetize the brake, magnetize the driven part, and then it would become solid. The magnetic particles would all clump together as if it was a solid connection. This gadget would read 200 characters per second going all out. But the computer had a millisecond clock rate. It took a millisecond to do anything, 3 milliseconds to do a multiply. I think I'm the only person who ever got the tape reader to read integers, six-digit integers, without stopping the tape. The tape flew through the reader and into a big bin, and if you got in the way, you could get hurt. And if there was any flaw in the tape, it would break. But, all right, so there I am boasting about trivia.
Yes.
But it was an interesting machine.
What happens next once you've got your program on a piece of paper?
Well, you go into this room where there's this console, and on the right-hand side of the console, there is this tape reader. There's also a Creed teleprinter and a card punch on the teleprinter. Behind you, at the side, there are these cabinets. The room, about twice as big as this room, was full of cabinets, and the cabinets were full of vacuum tubes. I think there were 5,000 of them. And, of course, they created a lot of heat, so there was the rush of air, air-conditioned air rushing through the cabinets to cool the vacuum tubes. And when you got on the computer, it was yours for typically maximum of 5 minutes. And you put your tape in there. I also built a tape winder so people could spool up, wind their tapes into these big spools, and you'd put that into the reader, and it would suck your tape in, and then it would execute your program, and then you would get a result, or maybe you wouldn't, and you'd get off the machine by the time your time was up, and the next person is right behind you, ready to start again, rebooting the machine from scratch. Mm-hmm. To read the tape and so on.
Yes, and the output would also be a paper tape?
You could get it as paper, but it would typically be punched on paper tape so you could print it out at your leisure, so to speak.
Right, so then you'd take the paper tape over to the...
You take it to another room.
Yep.
And run it through what amounted to a Creed teleprinter. And it would do what the teleprinters did with paper tapes. It would read the tape with little mechanical fingers that would poke up, and if they hit a hole, they would notice it, and if they didn't hit a hole, it would be stopped, and that would set up a bunch of complicated little levers and switches to get the printhead to work.
Yes. And you had mentioned that doing this, you discovered that programming was something that you enjoyed and were good at.
Oh, I got really good at it because, well, all I can say is that the idea seemed perfectly obvious once I saw what was there. It was just the right thing to do.
Yes.
But this machine had a fatal flaw. Its mean free time between errors was about 5 minutes on a good day. On a bad day, it could be less. And so I learned to write programs with redundancy and checkpoints and backup and all sorts of other stuff. I think I and Harvey Gelman were the only ones who were good at that. Harvey Gelman worked for the Atomic Energy of Canada, and he used the machine for the atomic energy calculations. He and I were the only ones who get the machine to do anything worth doing on a bad day.